lesson is out of the Gospel of Matthew, reading in chapter 23. Matthew chapter 23, verses 1 through 12. Sorry. I changed that one. Mark 5. Okay?
Sorry, I got it.
Yeah, I sent out a change to the Burlington folks, and I still got it. I didn't copy it over. Usually, Charles, I copy over everything I've got written, but I had so many prayer requests written, I didn't want to have to write them over again. So, let's go to Mark chapter 5. Sometimes things change between preparation and preaching. Mark chapter 5, we'll be reading those 17 verses there. Then they came to the other side of the Galilean Sea, to the country of the Gadarenes. And when Jesus had come out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no one could bind him, not even with chains, because he had often been bound with shackles and chains, but the chains had been pulled apart by him, and the shackles broken into pieces. No one could tame him anymore. And always night and day he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying out, cutting himself with stones. When he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and worshipped him. And he cried out with a loud voice and said, "What have I to do with you, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I implore you by God that you do not torment me." For he said to him, Jesus said to him, "Come out of the man, unclean spirit." Then Jesus asked, "What is your name?" And he answered and said, "My name is Legion, for we are many." Also, he begged Jesus earnestly that he would not send him out of the country. Now, a large herd of swine was feeding there near the mountains. So the demons begged him, saying, "Send us into the swine that we may enter them." And at once Jesus gave them permission. And then the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine. There were about 2,000, and the herd ran violently down the steep place into the sea, and they drowned in the sea. So those who fed the swine fled, and they told it in the city and in the country. And they went out to see what it was that had happened. Then they came to Jesus, and they saw the one who had them demon-possessed and had legion sitting and clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. And those who saw it told them how it happened to him who had been demon-possessed and about the swine. Then they began to plead with Jesus to depart from their region. How many of you have ever been to annual conference? I think Cheryl and Kate have, Dan has been. Annual conference is a unique experience. Anywhere from 2,000 to 2,500 pastors, spouses, and delegates that are representing the churches in West Ohio Conference. Now, one of the fascinating aspects is everybody at annual conference, when you register, everybody has a name tag. Mine's white. That tells a story. That says that I am an ordained elder in the church. I've got a little designation on the program that comes out, and it says RE. That says I'm a retired elder. But then on my name tag, there's a little pound sign. Nowadays we call that a hashtag. And that says I'm an elder. I'm a retired elder, but I'm an elder that's serving a church at the present time. Now, Sherry goes to conference with me. She represents you. And she has a yellow tag. That says that she's been elected as a local representative from the local church. But there are so many other designations that happen, and everyone has a different color. If you're a youth, you get one name tag. And then if you're an associate member, you get a pink name tag. If you're a probationary member, if you've completed all of the educational requirements, but you have not yet been ordained, you get a different color. If you're a local pastor, if you're a missionary, if you're a visitor to annual conference. Now the reason is not so we'll all know what to call each other, because you can see the names that are printed, but the reason for all of the colors is to help the ushers. Because in any given business meeting, we'll vote on many things. There are some things, when it comes to matters of ordination, that only the white tag elders can vote. When they're electing lay delegates to general conference, clergy don't get to vote on lay delegates. Only the yellow card lay delegates get to vote. If there are some that have a voice, but they don't get to vote, so it's a way of setting up different designations all over, and when the ushers pass out ballots to 2,500 people, they just don't pass them out willy-nilly. They'll look up and down the aisle, and if you don't have your name tag on, you don't get a ballot. And if you've got the wrong color name tag on, you don't get a ballot either. All designations of things we call ourselves at annual conference. But then there's something amazing that happens sometimes before our business meeting, or sometimes in between two business meetings, or after, we have a worship service. Now everybody still wears their name tags, but the amazing thing is they don't mean anything in worship services, because the scripture encourages us that the ground is level at the foot of the cross. There's no one greater or lesser than anyone else. Jesus invites all of us to worship him. I began thinking a little bit. In worship, Jesus calls us worthy because of his sacrifice. But I got to thinking, isn't that the way we do life from childhood all the way through adulthood? Many people call other people different things. We might refer to them as nicknames. I won't embarrass anybody to ask what your nickname was growing up, but can't nicknames be cruel in children? I still remember that one of my many nicknames, I was called Skinny, didn't wear glasses, so they didn't call me Four Eyes, and I wasn't overweight, so they didn't call me Tank, but we have designations and nicknames, and sometimes those nicknames that children call each other hold on and cause us problems when we come into adulthood. Got to be thinking that Jesus, in his ministry, was constantly disrupting the name designations that people gave to other people. For instance, I read through the gospel accounts, and I found a lot of things Jesus did. There were the scribes and the Pharisees. They were the spiritually elite. They made the rules, and they decided who the good guys and the bad guys were. And so the scribes and Pharisees called themselves holy and called themselves special. And Jesus came along and he said, you're hypocrites. You're like painted tombstones. Y'all look pretty on the outside, but inside you've got attitudes that are not holy. There's a crowd one day out on the hillside, and they gathered to hear Jesus preach, and the day got away from them, and the crowd called themselves hungry and without food. What did Jesus call them? He said, you'll all have enough. He told his disciples, tell them to sit down. And he blessed and broke the five loaves and the two fish. He sent his disciples out. They gave, and it says, everyone had enough and more than enough till they were filled. And after that miracle, Jesus said, I will do exceedingly abundantly, because how many baskets full of leftovers did they have that day? 12 baskets of leftovers. One day the Romans got fed up with Peter. He's going out preaching this Jesus stuff, and so they grabbed Peter and they threw him in prison and they bound him with chains and they called him a prisoner and said, "That'll take care of Peter. We're not going to have to put up with him anymore." Jesus comes along and he sends an angel and the chains fell off and Jesus said, "You're free." Blind man called Bartimaeus. Everybody else called him helpless, hopeless, begging at the gate, depending on everybody else. Jesus said, "I'm going to change what people called you." And all of a sudden, because of Jesus, Bartimaeus could see again. Crippled man sitting by the temple one day. Society looked at that cripple and said, "You are worthless, and you're begging what we have that we've worked for, and you're totally dependent on other people. You're a drag on society." And Jesus healed him, and he went away walking and praising God. You go through Scripture. Lepers, you're separated. You're hopeless. Nobody wants. If you were a leper, you had to walk around all day and carry a bell. And anytime you got close to good, common folks like us, you had to ring the bell so they wouldn't get too close and yell out the top of your lungs, "Unclean! Unclean!" Jesus said, "There are no unclean people." And he healed him and allowed the lepers to go back into society. Today's scripture about a man that was an outcast. The townspeople called him crazy. The townspeople bound him with chains and shackles, and he lived out in the tombs. He yelled and screamed day and night, and he scared the kids. And everybody said, "Stay away from the crazy man." Jesus came along, and what did he do? He healed him. And when the townspeople met that crazy man the next time, he had clothes on, he was sitting down, and in his right mind. Crowds even got into calling Jesus names. They called Jesus a criminal, and they crucified him, hung him on the cross, threw his body in a borrowed grave, and said, "That'll take care of Jesus. We won't have to bother with him anymore." And God stepped in and said, "I'm going to call him Savior and alive." Just amazes me in Scripture. "Lazarus, you're dead." Jesus said, "Lazarus, come alive again." Zacchaeus was a tax collector and a turncoat working with the Romans to extract more taxes. Jesus called him redeemed. Right after the feeding of the 5,000 out on the hillside, a miraculous time of the power of Jesus and his miracles. Immediately after that, last week, the disciples were out on the Sea of Galilee. A storm came up, and what did the disciples say? Life-threatening. We're all going to die. Jesus doesn't care. And Jesus spoke and calmed the storm. People in the world are constantly looking around and saying, hopeless. And yet Jesus says, "I will give you hope." Everywhere Jesus went, he made a difference. And he changed the designations as to how people refer to other people. And I've discovered, as I read Scripture, people are always going to call you things. I've been in ministry for 4+ decades. People call me different things. And sometimes it may not be beloved pastor. But God says, "I want to call you something different." I want to list for you this morning 4 things that I want Jesus to call me. 4 things that will be life-changing for you and life-changing for me. If Jesus calls you and me these 4 things, we got some good times out ahead of us. But if Jesus does not call us these things, we're in a whole heap of trouble. Number one, out of all the things that Jesus could call me, I want Jesus to call me forgiven. Now, you've heard Sherry calls me a lot of different things. Normally she calls me honey. If she's mildly irritated with me, she'll call me Tom. If she's really, really frustrated and I climb up on a ladder or do something really dumb, she'll call me Elwood. If she's talking to some of you, she may say, he's my husband. I got a lot of tags on me. My kids call me Dad. My grandkids say Grandpa. My brothers say, I'm Brother Tom. I was called a son until both of our parents died. You call me Pastor. The United Methodist Church calls me a retired elder, retired and serving. Do you realize that Jesus is not going to call me any of those when I'm dead and gone and I go to heaven? Right now, I got a newsflash. Do you know that there will be no United Methodist pastors in heaven? I don't want to shock you. Surely there won't be any Baptists in heaven. I'll remind you, there won't be any Democrats in heaven, and there won't be any Republicans in heaven. Those are things we call each other. The only people in heaven are going to be the individuals where Jesus calls you and me forgiven. That's the only thing that matters. If we have the longest obituary that the Columbus Dispatcher or the Delaware Gazette has ever printed, if it doesn't say forgiven, none of that is really going to matter. Now, all the other names that we're called, all the designations that might come behind the hashtags and tell everybody about us, they're significant and they're important in our life here. But none of those have any eternal significance. I was so proud the day Sherry called me her boyfriend. Now, why? And then we got engaged, and she'd say, this is my fiancé. And then, he's my husband. And she calls me her friend. And I can't tell you the joy and the significance, but as much as I love Sherry and Sherry loves me, it doesn't make any difference. It only matters what Jesus calls me. John 3:3, a fellow came to Jesus and said, what do I have to do? What designations do I need to have in my life in order to get into heaven? And Jesus said, unless you're born again, you will not be able to see the kingdom of God. Scripture reminds us in Romans 3:23, here's the bad news. Every one of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. We are all sinners. But it says the gift of God is eternal life. That word sin is interesting. In the Greek language, the scriptures use an archer's term for sin. What is sin? Sin is having a target, and you got a bow and arrow, and you aim at the bullseye. Sin is when you aim at something and you miss it. It's missing the mark. We're called to be holy. We're called to love Him supremely. But when we try and we miss the mark and we're not completely holy, that's sin. Now, it amazes me because sin is an archer's term, and next Sunday is Father's Day, and I announced several weeks ago, you got to watch it on YouTube, because we're going to have an expert archer on, say, up on the platform with me. He was the state of Ohio archery champion 2 years in a row. Now, I'd love to have him set up a target right above Cheryl back there and demonstrate, but our sanctuary is too small, and he indicated to me, when you're in competition, you're 60 yards away. That's a long way. I couldn't even hit the target, let alone the bullseye. And you get, I don't know, 5 or 6 sets of 5 arrows each, And if you don't get all of them in the bullseye, you don't have a chance of being a champion. They measure how many fractions of an inch you are outside. So Dr. Kevin Edwards is going to be here. You won't get to see him shoot the bow and arrow, but he's making me a video. Charles, I forgot to ask you beforehand, can we have a TV set up next week? I'll help you lift it. But it's an archer's term, not only for sin, but it's an archer's term when it comes to raising children. Romans 6:23. The good news is the wages of sin, we're all sinners, right? The wages of sin is death. Everybody sins, everybody dies. But the gift of God he gives to us is eternal life, and it comes through Jesus Christ our Lord. No matter how long or impressive our obituaries are going to be, if it doesn't include one name, forgiven, there are no eternal significance to it. My prayer this morning is that every one of you would be able to say, if I get called nothing else in this life, I want Jesus to call me forgiven. Secondly, then after he calls me forgiven, I want Jesus, in spite of everything else, all my mistakes, all of my dreams, any accomplishments that I have, I want Jesus to call me free. Once he calls us free, he just kind of piles on additional blessings. It all comes out of being called forgiven, because if we aren't first called forgiven, he cannot set us free. John 8:36 says, therefore, find out what it's there for, if the Son of God, if Jesus calls us free, we're going to really, really be free. First of all, we're free from the penalty of sin. Remember, the wages of sin is death. Forgiven, we're free. We don't have to die spiritually. But there's more. We're free also from the guilt of sin. Doesn't make any difference how much sin we have committed. We're free from the penalty, but we're also free of the guilt. The Bible says there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Now, one of the sad things is Jesus can call us forgiven, and he can declare us free from the penalty and the guilt of sin, and sometimes we aren't able to forgive ourselves. I cannot tell you how many times in ministry I've heard individuals at an altar in a revival service just simply say to me, God can't forgive me. Oh, Pastor, you don't know everything I've done. I said, I don't need to know everything you've done. God can call you forgiven. And when he does that, he wants to call you free from all the guilt. You realize that we're harder on ourselves than Jesus is. 1 John 4:18 says, there is no fear in love, for the perfect love of God casts out fear, because fear involves torment. There was a medical study done decades ago, and a medical doctor came out and said, probably 60% of my patients' struggles would be solved, and the physical implications of all the stuff that's going on in the mind and in their emotion, if they could simply believe that you are forgiven and you are free. Jesus wants to set us free. He wants us to live free. That means he wants us to be free from envy. The devil comes along and said, well, you don't have much. If you had more, you'd be happier. And Jesus said, I want to call you free from envy. He makes us free to love others. Now, I heard a paraphrase where the scripture says, love your neighbor as you love yourself. And the paraphrase I heard was, and for goodness sake, don't forget to love yourself. some people just cannot be free from poor self-images. You see in the news reports this past week that President Trump pardoned a lady by the name of Alice Marie Johnson. She was a first-time drug offender, and she was kind of a runner for the drug lords. She lost a couple of family members. She lost her job. She was desperate. It was a way to make up money, make some money. And she was captured. She was tried, convicted, and sentenced. And she has already spent 22 years in prison. And several people went to the president and on her behalf asked for a pardon. And he pardoned her. Let me read to you what she said. After receiving 22 years, now she's a mother, she's a grandmother, and looking at the rest of her life in prison, here's what she said. I'm closer today to heaven than I am to earth. I've lost all those years. But she said this, and this is beyond politics. She said, Mr. President, I will spend the rest of my life validating that you gave me a pardon, and I want my life to live rejoicing that now I am free. Now, like Alice, we stand condemned to death. When Jesus calls us forgiven and free, we can have the response, Jesus, I was condemned to eternal death, but you pardoned me. I'm going to live every day, the rest of my life, loving you and serving you, and to make you proud that you pardoned me for my sin. Number three, what else do I want Jesus to call me? I want Jesus to look at me and call me faithful. Now I know we can look back on our lives as Christians and we remember that he's always faithful, right? He always keeps his promises, but we haven't always been faithful. Remember where scripture says, I want you to be holy just like I'm holy. Now it's easy to think of Jesus as holy, right? Son of God, sinless. Hard to think of ourselves as holy. But we're also to be faithful. After that hillside miracle of feeding 5,000, the disciples watching that, they immediately get in a boat. When they got on a boat, they're saying, wow, Jesus is powerful. They got in the boat and the waves came up. And when Jesus found them, they were terrified. They thought they were going to die. And his comment to them was, what happened to your faith? You've lost your faith. It's a beautiful song. I love hearing it sung by quartets and individuals. And it's simply a song by Linda Randell. And it's called The God of the Mountain. Now, it's easy to trust Jesus when you're in the midst of a miracle. And God's good. He's pouring out blessings. Everything's going on. Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've ever known. But things change when you're down in the valley. Don't lose your faith because you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. And when things go wrong, he will make them right. And the God of the good times is still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still the God in the night. We talk of faith way up on the mountain, but talk comes easy when life is at its best. But it's down in the valley with trials and temptations. That's where your faith is really put to the test. I want God to call me faithful. Remember a conversation that God had with Satan, and Satan was saying, well, why wouldn't people love you? You give them everything. And God said, have you looked at my servant, Tom, or her? has called us by name. God says, look at my follower. They're faithful. And Satan said, well, why wouldn't they be faithful? You've given them everything. They're richer than anybody can imagine. They've got everything. And God said, go ahead. Test him. Try him. And the devil threw everything he could at old Job. Took away his family, took away his wealth and his barns and everything. And his wife and his advisor said, you've wasted your time following God. Why don't you just curse God and die? Because obviously God doesn't love you. And Job said, I came into this world naked. I'm going to leave naked. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Wouldn't you love God in speaking of you, say, have you considered my servant and call you by name and said they are faithful? Doesn't say perfect. It says faithful. I want Jesus to call me faithful. There's one more thing I want Jesus to call me. Now, I want him to call me forgiven right now. And I want him to call me free right now. And I want him to call me faithful day by day. And when I'm unfaithful, I want to confess my unfaithfulness and my failings so that he will again call me forgiven, free, and faithful. The final thing I want Jesus to call me, I'm in no hurry to have him call me that. I want Jesus to call me home. Some of us are closer to being called home than others. But the difficulty is, we don't know when that is going to be. But to hear that comment, well done, good and faithful servant, enter in to the reward that I have for you. You want something interesting to do sometime when we're singing hymns. You'll notice it in, you don't need to turn to it now because I want you to pay attention to the last 3 minutes of the message. Victory in Jesus. Most of the hymns of our faith, it starts talking about in the first verse about how we found faith in Christ. The second, third, or fourth verse talks about our journey. And in so many of the hymns, the last verse talks about heaven. You'll see that in our opening hymn, and you'll see that in our closing hymn, which, by the way, is not 363. It's 362. You can make that editorial change. But he's going to call us home. What's it going to be like? Let me give you a testimony of the hymnal. Because God's promise is this. The longer I serve him, the sweeter it grows. But this world is not my home. It'll be a happy day when the roll is called up yonder. Beyond the sunset, happy day. I'll see him face to face, and now I'll finally understand the mountaintops and the valleys, and he'll say, well done. What's that going to be like? That will be glory for me when I stand on Jordan's stormy banks on the sweet by and by. What's going to happen when we all get to heaven? We'll understand it better by and by. We sing, I've got a mansion. We're not in a hurry to get there, but it'll be great. On board for the promised land, I'm going home, I'll fly away. We're marching to Zion. There's Beulah Land on the old ship called Zion. I'll see you in glory, and we'll talk it over in the sweet by and by. You can hold off, as far as I'm concerned, on the fourth thing to have Jesus call you. We're not in a hurry to get home. But make sure today that as Jesus looks in your life, I want to be sure in my life, that he's going to look down and call me forgiven. He's going to call me free. Free to love, free to forgive, free from vengeance, because he said vengeance belongs to him. That's way above our payday to be vengeful toward others. But then look forward to the real promise that he's going to call us. I love the chorus that we sing up at camp. He paid a debt that he did not owe. I owed a debt that I could not pay. I needed someone to purge my sins away. And now I sing a brand new song, Christ Jesus paid the debt that I could never pay. A beautiful story back in Matthew chapter 18. Remember, the king had the servants, and he called one servant in, and it said, this servant owed a debt to the king of 60 million denarii. Now, I had no idea what a denarii was. We got nickels and dimes and quarters. The Bible experts tell us that a denarii is worth one day's wage. So whatever you receive for a daily wage, and he had 60 million of those. What Jesus was trying to say was, if he lived till he was 1,000 years old, he could never earn enough to pay off that unpayable debt. But the king in the parable called him in, you've got this unpayable debt, and I'm going to wipe it clean. Would you be thankful today if somebody came around and wiped out all of your debt, car payment, house payment, everything else? You'd be really happy, right? So this guy had an unpayable debt of 60 million denarii, and he was so excited and so grateful that he said, boy, that's a pretty good thing. So he went out and he found one of his servants that owed him 100 denarii. 100 days' wage. Payable. Give me enough time and I'll pay it back. And this ungrateful debtor, who was forgiven an unpayable debt, said, I want my money now. And he had him thrown into prison, said, you're going to stay in prison until you pay me every last penny. And the king heard, and he came back. He said, I paid off your unpayable debt. We need to live as though our debt has been paid and we've been forgiven. And then the king said, I'm reinstituting your debt because you did not live as one who had been forgiven much. Every one of us that Jesus calls forgiven, we've been forgiven an unpayable debt, and his command to each of us is go and live as though you're forgiven. Live as though you're free. Live faithfully to serve Jesus, and one day he'll call us home. That's my prayer for each of us this morning. So many prayer requests this morning.